Hello and welcome to Let's Talk Sports. I am Ralph LaBella.
It's been a month, so we have lots of fresh material. First, what do you do about young players to try to avoid injury? There's not a whole lot you can. Dante Exum of the Utah Jazz blew out his ACL, and he's out for the season. He injured himself in a FIBA game, and it's just one of those things. Nobody's going to tell the Celtics that Olenek and Sullinger shouldn't work out, shouldn't train, shouldn't work on their game. You can't get better unless you play.
Right. I mean, the Celtics are working out almost every day in Waltham. I mean, that's Ainge's request of that and Stevens, and they're there. I mean, they're really excited about the season coming up. But again, they're working out. They're not on vacation, you know, goofing off. And that's what happens. It happens to a lot of players, right. That's a shame.
And it's a big part of being a competitor, which brings us to our main topic here. What separates the great competitor from someone who's less? And I'm reading a book right now, which is What Drives Winning by a guy named Brett Ledbetter. Now, Ledbetter was Mr. Basketball in Missouri about a little bit more than 10 years ago. He was a heck of a player, and he said he used to put a little index card in his sock, and it would say 35, 5, and 5, meaning he wanted to get 35 points, 5 rebounds, and 5 assists, and he'd check it at half court at halftime and see what he needed to do. Now, as a basketball development coach, he says, that was the stupidest thing I could imagine. He says, all I was concerned about was Brett Ledbetter. It was about me. It wasn't about developing my whole game. It was just, how could I get myself more exposure? I wasn't thinking about my teammates. And that really is where we launched tonight.
Well, that's a bad attitude. I know some high school players that thought the same way, and their parents made them think that way. That it's all about you, number one.
Well, he starts off his book and he says, what does a young player hear when they get home when the brother or sister or parent hasn't been at the game? Number one, how'd the team do? Did you win? And number two, how many points did you score? And obviously society values winning. Now, his point is that, yes, results matter, but below results, that get you to results is process. And below that, he spoke to Mike Krzyzewski and 14 other college and professional coaches, and he said, character is what drives the process. And he discusses performance, or what you might call individual character, and moral, how you interact with other people. So he might say, for example, if commitment is the skill that you need, then it's if you have the commitment to work on a skill or a set of skills, set time in a very constructive way, that's going to drive the process, and it's also going to interact with how other people see you, because that's who you are. So really, we should be working more on developing the character of players than just teaching them how to do some isolated
skills. Well, explain that, though. What do you mean by character of player? The way they should be thinking the game?
Well, I'm talking about their individual values. Now, I spend a lot of time talking to the kids, you know, and I'll say, it's really important what books you're reading, how you're treating each other, how you're thinking. Are you offering to help your parents during your time off? How are you spending your time off? So if you talk about commitment, if you talk about focus, if you talk about accountability, all the individual things that great competitors have, then those individual values are going to drive what you do, how you live, and that's going to help your process and results, rather than just say, well, I'm just going to go work out because I really want to get a scholarship to college.
So I'm not disagreeing with you.
Right.
But how does that make you a better player?
No, he's saying the highest character individuals are going to be the ones who have the core values, the commitment, the focus, the attentiveness, the energy, the enthusiasm, the willingness to share, that will make them the great players. And that will also carry over into what he says is person comes before player. Value the player as a person first. They're important as a person. I care about you as a person. I care about your development as a person. And he says, when you do that, it rubs off on them as a player. Obviously we always see a guy like Rondo, you know, we don't know Rondo. We don't know what kind of guy he is, but we know he's very intelligent, and he's willing to share the basketball, but he seems selfish in the way he plays basketball. Selfish, and he's looking for statistics as part of his game rather than just facilitating the smooth operation of the offense.
Yeah. I mean, my key, listening to that, and my key to being a tremendous competitor is mindset. It's as simple as that. What's your mindset when you come to the practice field or to the game? Is your mindset that you understand what has to be done? You know that what your identity is as a player and as a team. You know, you can have a ton of character. I mean,
you have to have skills. Nobody would say
no,
that.
But you can have character without having a good mindset. Maybe you don't have mindset for basketball, even though you're a character. But I know what you're saying.
Right.
If you have character, you're in a better position.
I'm saying that if you're a person who's committed, you're going to be doing your schoolwork. If you take piano lessons, you're going to be doing whatever you need to do for your scales, your short compositions, all those elements that are important for your growth. And it's very difficult. Basketball is a game that requires many years to develop the skills. Nobody just shows up and is a good basketball player. That just doesn't happen.
But you know what I look at is I look at former high school players that have no character, that have been some of the best players we've had. You know, when I'm talking about character, would walk by you and just, you know, not even look at you, not say hi, not care at all about their teammates, always worried about make sure they get their points and whatever. You know, I know of high school players like that were the best we've had, that I would say have no character at all. Unbelievable mindset going into the game, knowing what they want to do, and they'll do it, and they're tremendous competitors. So, I mean, I understand what you're saying.
Right.
But to me, it's the mindset to be a great competitor is number one.
Well, the question is, can you develop character? And I think you can. I don't think that you just have people who have no character or some character or high character. I think a player can be taught to care. I think they can be taught to care about their teammates more. I think they can be taught to care about the game more in every way. I mean, like I'm not a yeller at the referees. I just find it, in middle school basketball, yelling at the referees doesn't really do much, especially in the summer, really doesn't. It doesn't
help
anybody.
You haven't got one technical foul yet?
Oh, not even close. Not even close. So
because I've had one in the last year?
No, I mean, like, last night, you know, I'm over at the scorer's table near the end of the first half, and I the other coach is there, and I said, what, are we shooting a video on how not to play basketball here tonight? And he laughed.
But then they played better, though, your team, the second half.
We played very well the second half. It was just the first half, I don't know, we weren't that into it.
I remember Mark Pearson telling me all the time when he was coaching with us, Ralph, forget about it. The next game is a new game, and things will be different. And he was so right.
Well, I think the other part of it is a player needs to be surrounded by the right influences, just like adults need to be surrounded by the right influences. You know, you lie down with dogs, you get fleas. So every player should be able to identify some both peers and adults that they can talk to, try to get reasonable advice on how to improve themselves as a person and potentially improve themselves as a basketball player. So John Calipari, coach of Kentucky, has what he calls the personal board of directors. He has three or four people that he meets with, you know, several times a year, discusses life, finances, etc. And if he says something that they think doesn't make any sense, then they'll tell him. And he says, I'll have to think about that.
Yeah, but, you know, getting back to being what makes a great competitor, you know, you look at the kids that we're coaching, the young kids, you know, and they're working hard at their game. But I think it's so important as an athlete to be in the best shape you can possibly get into. I mean, it's just things that, you know, on the court you can't do if you're not in great shape. Like, you know, I was down after last week's game. We were playing some great basketball this year. Last week's game we had six players, and it seemed like, you know, the other team was playing a zone and we weren't hitting our shots. We were up the first half, and then all of a sudden it was like, you know, their will to compete ended. You know, they weren't giving everything they had because they were tired. And I think they were using that as an excuse, so it was getting to them mentally because they weren't hitting their shots and they were tired.
Well, we all know that
it's the summertime too.
If a player has an excuse to fail, they will, you know, because I'm tired, I didn't get a good night's sleep, I stayed out too late, I went to the movies, I was at a sleepover. I don't feel that good. I had a cold last week. Well, you're either there to give it your best effort or you're doing something less. And when you're working or I'm working, I can't decide to go to work and say, I don't really feel like it today. I'm not gonna ask the right questions. I'm not going to pay attention to my work. It's important to always work to give the best you can. There's gonna be nights when you go and, I mean, Ledbetter makes the point. He says, the other reason was ridiculous for him to be making this 35-5-5 statement. He says, like, what if the other team plays zone? What if they decide to double team me the whole game? What if other guys are hot on the team and I should be passing them the ball? I can't control any of that. And it's ridiculous for me to be trying to jack up shots against double teams just to meet some arbitrary goals that I set for myself.
Yeah, and you know, and like my players and the parents understand that I'm a coach who expects 100% every second. And when you don't get it for whatever reason, you know, like last game is the first time in a long time. I mean, we've got hammered, you know, playing in that Metro West League last year. And, you know, we've played some good ball too. And last week, it was the first time that I said, I can't even get on them. I can't get on them anymore. I mean, they just didn't have it. They were tired. But six players, I told them, I said, you should be able to run the whole game. You're 13 years old. You should be in the shape. And you get girls like Colleen Hanscom, they could play three games in a row and you wouldn't think they were tired. They wouldn't have to come out. They wouldn't want to come out. You know, Hannah Brickley, she wouldn't want to come out of the game. And I'm trying to tell these girls, you've got to be in shape. And sometimes it gets to them mentally. You know, but the thing what I want to say too is, you know, you may have out of the girls, two girls that are given 100% all every, so you got to get on the team, and you, and the girls that are the two girls that are given everything they have, I mean, they got to hear from the coach too.
Right, and most players, I would say, even if you asked most high school players, what are the core values or the core philosophy of your organization, they would just look at you with a blank stare. To me, basketball, first of all, is a game where you have to get more and better quality shots than the other team. More and better quality shots. That means the other team gets no quality shots or one bad shot. And offensively, the game's about spacing, cutting, and passing. I go to the game and I hear dribble, 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 dribble. I mean, I don't even have to watch the game. I hear the game. It's terrible. And players have to understand how the game is played. If you watch UConn women, if you watch Golden State, the ball is whipped around the perimeter. People cut. If there's an opportunity for an easy shot, then they get it. Other people say set screens, they come off screens, you know, get open shots. They get separation to get high quality shots. And at the other end, they play aggressive defense. They put pressure on the ball. They don't allow ball penetration. They don't allow people in the paint. They contest all shots and they rebound ferociously on the defensive boards. You do those things, you're going to be successful if you can put the ball in the basket.
What other team, when you were just talking about Golden State, you know, you got to, you know, moving the ball around, what other teams
started
doing?
Well, the Celtics do a pretty good job moving the basketball.
The Celtics do a real good job of that, and they're going to be one of the, I'll tell you, this year, they're going to be the surprise of the league, although some teams know that they're getting better.
Right.
They're going to be, I'm telling you, they're going to be the surprise of the league this year.
Well, a lot of offenses are designed on not only ball screens, what they call spread pick and roll. You hear Scalabrine talking all the time, but off ball screens. So you need mobile bigs, which are the Crowders, the Drebkos, the Amir Johnsons.
Lee.
Yeah, well, you know, Lee's. But
he's good going to the hoop.
Yeah, the whole thing about the guys like Draymond Green, these 6'8 guys who can shoot from the perimeter. Mickey, I don't know. I don't know how he's going to be defensively away from the basket. In the summer league, he looked pretty good near the basket.
Yeah, he's very athletic. So yeah. If they play the up-tempo game, he's going to be perfect for that team.
Right.
He's going to be blocking shots, running the floor. It's going to be perfect. They get so many options on this team this year.
Right. They have.
I mean, Ainge is so excited about this
group. I mean,
they
have too many players and not enough minutes. So, for example, if you only could have one guy, would you want Sullinger or do you want Olenek? If you have to choose one.
Well, I know what you'd pick. We both pick opposite. I like Olenek. You like Sullinger.
Well, I like Sullinger because I think he's a better rebounder and a more physical player. Olenek, when Sullinger's having a not-so-good game, at least you see him. When Olenek's having a not-so-good game, you don't even know if he's playing.
But here's what happens with Olenek. They don't involve Olenek a lot in the game. If they don't involve him in that half-court game, you don't see him much. But when they involve him, when he gets his hand on the ball, when he sets the picks and pops off those picks, he's very good. But the best player on the team at defending the pick and roll is Olenek. You watch him next year. He's very good. He shuts down a penetration, then recovers really well.
Well, I agree. I think the Celtics will make the playoffs. I think they have a chance to maybe even be one of the top four seeds. Not one, two, or three. Maybe they could be a four seed.
Why not two?
I don't think they're going to be better than Chicago, and I don't think they're going to be better than Atlanta.
Chicago's got a new coach. I mean, losing.
Yeah, Hoiberg's a smart guy. He knows what he's doing.
But, I mean, I think the Celtics have a shot of getting. When you saw them in the playoffs, they did the best job against Cleveland.
Well, it should be really interesting to see the NBA this year. You've got Billy Donovan in Oklahoma City. Now, obviously, Oklahoma City lives and dies with how Durant is. If his foot doesn't get better, then he's got trouble. And then I think Chicago, a lot of people felt Thibodeau was too hard on the players. Conversely, I mean, obviously Ainge says nothing but good things about Stevens, which was fine. I think he deserves that. But there was an article about Jared Dudley talking about how players are talking about they respect Stevens a lot, and it would make the Celtics a consideration to play because they want to play for Stevens at the right money. Nobody's going to give up tons of money to come here.
No, I mean, the future of the Celtics looks very good. I mean, compared to last year, beginning of last year, where they are now, I mean, who could have expected more than this other than the draft getting the top pick?
Well, if there weren't any of the games against Cleveland where they, you know, people could say they weren't at least competitive. I'm not to say they were going to win the game, but they were in the game. And at the end of the season on the West Coast trip, they played Golden State really tough. And, you know, you say, well, why do you need a guy like Rozier? Well, if the nuclear weapon or the Golden State Warriors is Curry, then you're going to need defenders that can get up on guys and chase them around.
Well, you also need Rozier, because what if you're going to trade Smart and someone like Sellinger?
Right.
What if you're going to make that deal? You know, you have Rozier there backing up Thomas.
Right. So the guy who I see as what do you do with him this year is Turner. I mean, is he a two, is he a three?
Especially with Rozier. He's going to make a deal. He's got to make a deal with all the talent he has.
Right. And if Summer League is Summer League, so, you know, you don't want to get crazy about seeing guys. But R.J. Hunter, I mean, he looked like he knew how to play basketball at least. Coach's son, knows how to pass the ball, knows how to find open spaces. He just looked like a player. I'm not saying he's going to come in and get 10 game points a game, anything like that.
Yeah, but you look at the Celtics run, right? They're 15 players. If you rate them throughout the league, they're 15 players. The 15th player is not going to be one of the worst players in the league.
Right.
I mean, they don't have any players that are weak. They don't. They have 15 good basketball players. How good are they going to get?
Right. They don't have nickels and dimes. They've got quarters and 50-cent pieces, but they don't have any dollar bills.
No. Oh. Thomas could be, though.
Yeah, Thomas could be.
And so many other guys. You don't know Smart.
People like Smart a lot.
I don't know where Crowder's going to get to.
Right. I'm very suspicious that Smart's going to get hurt just the way he plays.
And how about Johnson, too? We didn't even talk about him.
Well, you know, Johnson's very good. He's another guy who's good at defending the pick and roll, and he's good near the basket. So we'll see. And he's a scrappy guy. So I think the fans are going to like him as well. We'll be right back. Welcome back. Tonight, Lou joins us to discuss the sad, strange tale of the Boston Red Sox. A World Series winner 2 years ago, surrounded by three cellar-dwelling, unwatchable teams. Lou, what's your main view on the Sox?
Well, where do you begin? You know, when you get three holes in the dam and you only have two fingers pitching, I don't think some of the guys on the team are living up to their contracts. Guys can't hit consistently. Where do you want to begin? What do you, you know what I mean? It's like, what do you want to fix first?
Right, there's so many.
Flat tire.
There's so many damaged goods. You know, take a guy like Buchholz. Obviously, one of the five number ones. Can't stay on the field. He did pitch well for a string of 8 to 10 games. No question about it. But then he has an elbow injury. What else is new?
Yeah.
And Now he's out. He might as well stay out for the rest of the season. There's no real point in bringing him back.
Yeah, they moved him on the 60-day DL. So, I mean, you know, that's pretty much like guaranteeing that what's he going to come back? September 12th, pitch like two games, and then everybody will say, oh, but look how good he pitched when he was on the field. And you know, this has followed him every year, doesn't it? He'll have this part of the season where he pitches like crap. Then he has a part of the season where he throws like an ace. Then he has a part of the season where he's not able to help them because he's injured or hurt.
You know, when you talk about a team finding their identity, well, you have to find it first before you can have an identity. They just haven't found their identity.
Well, I think my suspicion is that there's something intrinsically wrong with the culture because you have guys like Sandoval and Hanley Ramirez who really seem like they're not that into it. They're out there playing. You know, if the ball's hitting the gap, Ramirez will sort of almost run after it. But mostly he wants to get his four at-bats, hopefully jack one out of the park and go home. Where Sandoval might play a little bit harder, but he's not a very good third baseman. We've seen that.
Well, I think you're right about you say, you know, they don't have any personality. You know, like the Red Sox teams in the past, I'm not talking about, you know, just the whole cowboy up thing, you know, but they don't seem to have any kind of identity with, you know, these are the Red Sox that we love, or this is the Red Sox that Pink Hat Nation has been into. It's almost like rank and file. Turn the game on, be disappointed, turn the game off.
Well, do you remember the shots in spring training when they showed them down in Florida? What was the one thing you always saw? Who were the three players that were always together on every shot?
Ortiz, Ramirez, Sandoval. Okay. So you have a clique of guys who, I've got mine.
Every time I saw a game or them down there interviewing anybody, you always saw the three of them together joking around with their hats off, you know, not working, but, you know, they knew the cameras were there. And you got that clique there, you know, they're a clique here. You know, Pedroia, he gets along with just about everybody. But who else? Who else? What other players? Like you said, Buchholz, he always gets injured. When you talk about an identity, you're waiting for him to get injured again, even though he's pitching well.
Well, you
can't have that frame of mind where, you know, your identity's there and you're feeling good about him because you know something's going to be happening.
Well, you had a player like Victorino who was trying to come back from injury, never really did come back from injury successfully for any extended time, who during spring training was lobbying that they acquire more pitching and maybe trade, let's say, an outfield prospect who would happen to be taking his job.
Yeah.
What's that about? You know, just trade my teammate, trade my competition away.
Exactly.
See, but here's what I look at. I look at it like, say I'm a player who gets, they give $20 million to, like Ramirez. Instead of goofing off half the time, I'll be in left field catching fly balls, playing the wall. The wall's not as high as Fenway, but it's something like it.
Do something.
Making throws a second, really working hard. None of the reporters ever said he was working out there. So you got those three guys clowning around. You got other guys who, what other stars did you have? You had Napoli, who had a pretty good year last year.
And
you know, but what,
dropped
you know,
off.
How's he going to lead the rest of the players? Who's going to follow him? You know what I mean? Pedroia really keeps to himself in a way. He shows by his play.
Right.
But there's nothing there where just to get the whole group together.
2 years ago, I remember Mike Lynch saying, whatever you thought about Jim Rice, if he had a bad game, he'd say, yeah, I struck out three times. Had a bad game, that hurt us today. Or before practice, he'd be out there taking fungos off the wall, working on his game to become a good player. You had another guy like Greenwell, who spent all his time schmoozing with the reporters to try to be media friendly and PR friendly, look good in the press. So his final 6 years here averaged 10 home runs and 60 RBIs, which is pitiful.
Yeah.
And yet, Gator Greenwell, he's a great guy. Well, I mean, I think Daniel Nava's a great guy. It just didn't turn out that he could perform at a major league level this year.
Well, and that's the problem. They've had too many Navas, you know. They've had too many of those guys putting up these numbers. And, you know, like I always say about the dreaded word potential, you know. It's like you want to hold on to these guys, you know, like Kelly. Is Kelly going to be a major league pitcher? I don't know. You can't teach somebody speed, but you can definitely teach hitters how to jack speed right out of the park. So, you know, I think he's got the goods, but maybe next year he comes back. Maybe he's the same guy. Maybe he's a setup guy. Who's going to be their starters? I mean, you look at this now. You talk about Buchholz. Do you even want to see him in a Red Sox uniform as a fan? I would trade him for whatever I could get. Because you know what? All we have in the world of statistics, they talk about the sample size. The sample size is that he gets injured every year.
Well, one of the things about the Patriots historically is they sell high. You know, Richard Seymour will trade you for a number one.
Yeah.
You know, whereas it's always better to trade the guy a year early than a year late because they have no value anymore. And, okay, it's different contract structure and so forth for football, but the Red Sox, they're selling low on everybody, it seems.
Well, if they're going to blow it up, they got to blow it up. I mean, they can't, you know, there's no more of what they're trying to do. They did not work what they did. If anything worked, I don't know. I know they paid Hanley Ramirez, maybe because they didn't go after a $200 million pitcher that they saved money, you know, but they got to do something next year.
But you really think about it, when they say he's a clubhouse guy, most they're talking baseball in regard to that. When you hear it, 90% of the time, he's a clubhouse guy, it refers to baseball. Well, who's a clubhouse guy? I mean, I would say Pedroia is a clubhouse guy. He's been injured a lot. But what about these young players? Who do they have to
follow? He can't do it alone, though.
They're not going to follow Ortiz, who doesn't want to play first base.
I remember going to the game 161, I don't know, at least 15 years ago. They're playing Baltimore. The Red Sox are winning 8-3, bottom of the eighth. There's a man on first. Ball's hit to right field. There's an overthrow to third base. The runner's going to third. And B.J. Surhoff is backing up the play from left field, which, I mean, there wasn't any reason for him to do that. Neither team was fighting for anything. They were just playing out the string.
That's how you play a
game. He was being professional. And until they get enough players, a cadre of players that are committed to being professional, and then I think the commitment has to start with management, and it doesn't look like there's a commitment to management when you keep running the same management out, doing the same foolish management things. Now, they get rid of Lucchino. I don't know if that's going to mean anything or not.
But you know what makes me laugh, too, with these Red Sox fans? Remember how I tell you the Red Sox fans are basically the worst fans? They really are. When you really think about it. You know, they thought it was great when they got Crawford and Gonzalez, and we were saying it's a bad move, too much, $23 million to Gonzalez, giving up five-year top prospects, of which Rizzo was one of them.
Yeah.
Signing Crawford to $20 million when you had Ellsbury making $5 million in center, who's a better player. I mean, they're bad moves. But I mean, and the fans loved it, and then when things went bad, they hated it. Same thing, you know, when you look at the way things are going now, it's the same thing with the fans. Now they say they should have kept Theo. Do they remember what Theo did the last 2 years here? He made eight of the worst moves in the history of baseball.
Well, that's the truth.
He started this whole thing.
Only in Green Bay can you finish in last place.
But now they want him back.
That's the thing. So you're right, though. I'll tell you.
The Red Sox fans, they just...
The problem, though, is they made too many bad moves. They made too many non-moves. I mean, if you could do it over again, you keep Ellsbury, right? It's not, right now, it's the most obvious no-brainer anybody would say.
I would say Ellsbury, okay, he's only played in 60 games this year. He's had four home runs.
Oh, I agree.
22 RBIs. Basically, if you pay $20 million for a guy, you don't get $20 million of
production
back. Right,
but that's the fan perspective would be, oh, we should have never got rid of Ellsbury. It was a good non-signing. They saved a lot of money on a guy that didn't end up doing
that. What happened was it was a good decision by the Red Sox, but it hurt them in the long run.
Because they didn't have anyone to replace
him. It was a good decision by the Yankees. The Yankees have plenty of money.
Well, the Yankees...
What's the difference between giving Ellsbury 15 and 22?
It all depends on did it work, did it not work. Well, the Yankees upgraded. The Yankees upgraded. They got a better leadoff hitter. They got a better center fielder. It killed us because, you know, it's not a matter of him going to New York. He left, and we replaced him with Jackie Bradley Jr.
Right. So, well, and ultimately, if you're a rich team now, you're held hostage by your own money.
Right.
You end up overpaying for guys who are probably going to underachieve, and you overpay guys like Sandoval, who is a very good player in the postseason. He's kind of an average player during the regular season, but nobody would say, having watched him every day, he's a $19 million player, whatever that is.
Well, they thought, I know what they were thinking, they're going to be better off at third base with Sandoval, which they are.
Well, they thought his defense,
but they gave him big money, you know, and a team's not doing well. If the team was doing well, and he was hitting 270, playing okay third now, you know, it's definitely an upgrade from where they were last year. But Ramirez is the one. I mean, you go with a guy with that attitude, you're giving him $20 million.
And there's kind of a stealth factor that nobody's going to talk about that maybe was the biggest effect that nobody sees, because he's not playing, is Christian Vasquez. So he could handle the pitching staff. He could shut down everybody's running game. So sad to say, he can hit better than Swihart at this point in his career. Not that he's a great hitter. Swihart's still finding his way.
I think he's trying hard, Swihart.
You know, Swihart's making...
He's not Vasquez.
He's done all right, you know, for his first year.
I mean, Vasquez is, from what we saw last year, he's a better player than Swihart is right now. Maybe he won't be a better player in 5 years, but for right now, he is.
Maybe they're thinking is, you know, play Swihart, and maybe he'll get going, and then they can trade him at the end of the year with someone. Maybe with Betts and get a, you know, a top-notch player.
They don't have much in the way of trading. I mean, you trade, like I said, you trade Buchholz away for what? Anybody would want him because, you know, he was a legitimate Cy Young candidate for a short amount of time that 1 year. And when he's on, he's really on. But, you know, any team would take him for nothing. They're just not going to set. No one's going to give him anything.
Well, you have two pitchers at the end of the bullpen, Uehara and Tozawa, who are very good. Uehara at times excellent. Certainly has no velocity anymore, but somehow fools people and gets him out. But that he's only got 1 year left, if they don't sell him off this month. And the rest of the bullpen is a bunch of guys. You say Breslow, Robbie Ross. They come in and you just say, oh God, the game's over.
Yeah, just batting practice.
Well, what it is though now, it doesn't matter how good they are. I mean, they're out of it. You know, I always have said it's never over till it's over. You know, I mean, you still don't know, but pretty much it's over for them. And it doesn't matter what they have in a bullpen now. Because next year, with bullpens, you can establish a real good bullpen next year by making a couple of moves, signing a couple of plays. There's always relief.
Yeah, there's always guys out there you can get live arms. But my thing is, I just think it's the overall attitude. I don't see any kind of a passion coming out of the team. And, you know, it's like the only time Ortiz gets passionate is if it sounds like the Red Sox aren't going to pick up his option or give him a raise.
Well, he's at 487 on homers, and the rest of time is going to be about Ortiz getting to 500. I don't think he'll make it this year, but you never know. He might get hot, or some other pitchers might groove him one now and then to, facilitate owner-to-owner communication.
But, you know, the thing with Ortiz is if he's hitting real good, they're a pretty good offense.
Yeah,
but
he's
still
got it.
You look at him and you say, I mean, come on, let's be serious with him and A-Rod. They're on it. They're definitely on it. I mean, anybody who thinks they're not on it, they're not watching what I'm watching. He can't turn on a fastball 3 months ago again. He can't hit anybody. All of a sudden, his bat's quicker. Well, what did he do since then?
I'll tell
you. Same thing with A-Rod.
Whatever they got, I wish they'd give Napoli some, because have you seen? We've seen this before. An older power hitter just suddenly just drops off. He is swinging so hard at every single pitch. Like, the ball will go to the pike if he connects, but, you know, he's got a massive holes everywhere that guys are just blasting it through.
Well, if you look at the players and say, who has outperformed expectations in the everyday players? Probably Bogarts, and that's it. I mean, nobody else, and the people who have underachieved, like Napoli, have been way underachieved.
Bogarts mostly with his defense, too. I mean, he's hitting over 300.
Yeah, his defense
is has improved. He's quicker.
Absolutely, yeah.
He worked on his
now,
quickness.
His power may be gone because maybe he's lost something in the shoulders. He probably worked on his body.
Well, he worked on his quickness all winter, they said.
But you know what? If he hits 300, he can be a vacuum cleaner in the field.
I'm not crazy about him, though.
But he's a bright spot looking at next year.
But he gets a lot of hits, that a little ground ball hits. Yeah, he hits the ball sometimes. Good
there's
line
a place
drive.
For that, though. I mean,
no, but I mean, if he's going to hit 300, he's going to hit 300.
But he's got to hit 300, though, because you can't have a guy like that with no power.
Then you got Betts. Right. You got Owens and Johnson, although Johnson hurt his arm. He may be getting the Tommy John surgery. I don't know. But Owens looked good against the Yankees.
I was going to say, Owens, I thought he looked really good. And I don't think they shouldn't have taken him out. I think this babying of young pitchers.
Well, and are they going to shut down Rodriguez? Because he must be getting up near 125, 130
he's
innings.
He's pitching today, right?
Yeah. But what's the point in throwing him out there if you want to conserve innings by organizational philosophy? Why put him out there? Is he putting the people in the seats?
Yeah, well, that's the thing. Next year, I think, you know, you look going forward, what the bright spots for next year? You got four or five guys tops. I think Owens, if he makes the team, if they decide to keep him up, I don't know, if he pitches like he did the other night, you know, it looked good to me. And, you know, Rodriguez, the same thing.
What always takes those big lefties a long time to learn how to reproduce their delivery. Look at a guy like Randy Johnson early in his career. He's all over the place. And then by the time he was a fossil, he was unhittable.
Oh, even Sandy Koufax had a little bit of a, you know, slow start in that regard.
But they've made some bad moves, though. The shortstop for Detroit is Inglés, right?
Inglés, yes.
Yeah. If they kept him and didn't make that move, you'd have him at short, Bogaerts at third.
Yep.
Pedroia at second, if he wasn't hurt, or Holt. And then if you have Pedroia at third, you'd have Holt in left. You didn't have to pay the money to Sandoval and Ramirez, especially Ramirez, who's not a clubhouse guy.
Yeah,
right?
that's obvious, you had,
you go after a couple of good pitches. You know, and you'd have to pay the extra money for the pitches. But I like their philosophy at times. You don't want to give it to pitchers in their 30s, a 5 or 6 year contract. Look at Sabathia for the Yankees. That's the biggest disgrace, even more than A-Rod. When Sabathia played out his option after 3 years, $22 million a year, he plays out his option, and I say, as a Yankee fan, I'm saying, great, let him go.
They should have let him walk.
Cashman gives him a 5 year contract at $25 million a year.
And look at how he's pitching.
And look at him.
Yeah, well, you know
I
what?
I mean, it's a Cashman and Theo, they tell me how great these general managers are. Look at them.
It makes you wonder where they're getting their info
from. It's interesting that in basketball, which is a sport dominated by African Americans, no question about that. Most of the guys who are making big money are not dogs. They come out, they work hard, they are playing in the summer, they're doing something to improve their game. You don't, all right, you got a Josh Smith now and then who hasn't, but it's much easier to name the exception for the guys who got the big contract than to say, oh, Damian Lillard didn't deserve the money, or David Robinson in his day didn't deserve the money. Everybody seems to deserve the money.
Yeah, but
basketball.
Look at someone like Lido making 14, almost 15 million. There's players like him that shouldn't be making that money. Even though
right.
I like Lee,
right?
He's going to be with the Celts. I liked him when he was with the Knicks. I said I'd like to see the Celtics get him 14 million. I mean, for someone
I know,
like him.
But there aren't many players getting really big money that people would say, well, he's just a dog. Nobody should have ever paid him that money.
No, I mean you're right.
Rondo.
You're right because. They're stars of the league, most of the guys getting the
right.
money. And there's only five starters on the team.
Yeah, and you have
compared to baseball.
Right, and you have a few guys who, you know, are getting way too much money because, you know, who is the the U.S. soccer coach, the Klinsmann? He basically said, well, look at Kobe Bryant. You pay him $25 million a year. You're paying him for what he did 10 years ago. He's broken down. We don't like to do that in soccer. All right, I get that. And, you know, Bryant's going to make his... He says, well, we're going to make the playoffs this year.
But that can go either way, Ron. Look
Bryant
at Wilson.
Will be hurt.
No, but look at Wilson for Seattle making $1.5 million. Come on.
Right.
One of the top five quarterbacks in football making $1.5 million. So it goes both ways, you know. The guys are... And what's his name for Golden State? Curry.
Right.
He was making what, $9 million or something this year?
Whatever it is, it's not what
he's MVP.
Earned.
Don't forget, football's famous for that, though. You sign the rookie deal 5 years, and it averages out to be $1.5 million. Then you go on to be a Super Bowl winning quarterback, and it's like, thank you for playing. You're going to be making the same money next year.
Yeah.
We'll be right back. Welcome back. It's a toothache. It's a rock in the shoe. It's the nagging cough that won't go away. It's the Deflategate. The latest release of the Tom Brady appeal hearing notes has put the NFL a little bit on the defensive because Brady categorically denied having anything to do with instructing or any prior knowledge of football preparation concerning inflation pressures. And the NFLPA obviously got out ahead of that one because the NFL sought to maintain confidentiality and sealed records of previous hearings. What's it all going to mean? They're looking for a settlement. Apparently, the NFL offered Brady a two-game settlement as long as he confessed that he did it. He's not confessing. He says, I didn't do it. So the NFL is going to have to come back with something else. I don't see that Brady may still get suspended. He may still have to pay a fine for exactly what. He'll say, for being a thorn in the NFL's side, I guess.
Brady's not going to get suspended. That's my prediction. He's not going to get suspended. This all started after the Jets game when the ball was over 15 PSIs. Brady got upset, told his guys he wants the balls at 12.5. they even went to an official. The officials weren't following that rule anyway. I mean, the way it was going, it was a disgrace the way they were handling the balls. But they went to the officials and said, show them a copy of the rules that say 12.5 to 13.5. And they said, Brady wants it a 12.5. They weren't a 12.5. So that's where it all started. Brady wanted the balls at 12.5. I mean, since then, it started with Baltimore. Everybody knows it started with Baltimore over the kicking balls, number one. They started with the kicking balls, saying that Baltimore's balls were too hard, kicking balls. And then it went to someone saying that the Patriots, you know, deflate their footballs. And then it went from Baltimore to Indianapolis, went to the league, went to Goodell and Kensel.
Well, people want to say it's all Spygate. It's not all Spygate. It's four championships, six Super Bowl appearances. It's the value of the Patriots going from $160 million to $2.4 billion. It's 31 other owners saying they got theirs and they had to cheat to get it.
Spygate was a disgrace. Spygate was absolutely nothing. And Belichick should have come out with it. But Belichick, you know, as pompous as he is, he's not going to explain everything to anybody why he did it. He finally said it before the Super Bowl when they were getting on him, and when they referred to Spygate. And he says, Spygate, he goes, we were doing it in front of 80,000 fans. We had the camera in front of 80,000 fans like everybody else did. I know Belichick, he didn't want anybody to get the upper hand on him. Even though Goodell came down with the memo saying stop doing it, he knew other teams were still doing it. So he kept doing it. All the other team has to do is change one signal and then forget about it. So all the Patriots that have talked about it since then said, we didn't even know about that. What did we get out of it? We got nothing out of it. So forget Spygate. That was absolutely nothing. This case here, we talked about it. Goodell wanted to get his reputation back. The best way to get your reputation back is go after the face of football, Tom Brady, and he's white. It's as simple as that. He had to make up to the Rice, the people that back Rice, the people that back Peterson. Hey, I'm going to go after the superstar now. I want to make everybody happy. I want to get my popularity back. And that's what he did with that idiot Kensel, his partner there, and Vincent. Vincent's his stooge, number one stooge. Kensel and Vincent were in the locker room at halftime during the Indianapolis game when they're not supposed to be in there. The rules state you're not supposed to be in there involved in anything at halftime. And they're in there checking the footballs. So when I said it was a sting months ago, it was a sting. Anybody who says it wasn't a sting, I mean, it was a perfect situation for Goodell to get his popularity back. Now it's backfiring on him. Brady will get no suspension. He won't agree to any agreement. The NFL's not going to agree to anything. You know, that guy Pash, whatever his name is, the legal mind.
Right. Well, apparently the NFL.
He's as bad as them.
The NFL attorney Pash had to sign off on the agreement before it went final. So he had apparently the ability to change some of the wording or so forth. So that an independent report is getting reviewed by the NFL before its final submission.
You're talking about the Wells report.
Right.
Right. He edited the report.
I know. So how is that an independent report? It's not an independent report.
I mean, when
report.
A judge gets a hold of that, are you kidding me? The NFL's, I don't see how the NFL can agree to no games and just a fine after spending $5 million doing all this.
Well, right. It's a massive face-saving episode. So they have to extract something. Now the judge may say, you've already gotten $1 million and two draft choice from the Patriots, and you already have it in your bylaws that a fine is $25,000, and now you're just coming in off the reservation with some unprecedented penalty, and there's no justification for it.
You know, the only problem, especially Mortensen's article, Mortensen blew this, you know.
And which is still on ESPN, has still never been retracted.
Well, he finally did something the other day.
He took his tweet off.
Yeah, and Kensel is the guy that gave him the information. He's the attorney for Goodell.
Well, I don't know if we know that for a fact.
No, he did. He gave him that information about the 13 or 14 footballs, two PSIs under.
Right. Obviously, the difference, if you correct use the ideal gas law and everything else, was 0.2 PSI between the Colts and the Patriots footballs. And the Colts, three of the four footballs they had measured were underinflated, which nobody seems to talk about, as well as the fact that they're sat around in a warm room longer than the Patriots. They had a chance to warm up. I mean, we coach basketball all winter long. The balls are in the car. they're freezing cold. You bring them into the gym, you can't play with them. They got to warm up first. And like, everybody who's ever played sports knows that.
That was a good lesson for our girls, though. We explained to them one day at practice, I explained to the girls, this is the problem they're having with the footballs. And they said, yeah, that's right. But, you know, you look at the whole thing. A lot of people say, well, why did Brady say, I don't think so? Remember when he gave his...
Right, are you a cheater, or did you cheat?
And he says, I don't think so. The reason why he said he didn't think so, a report from Mortensen comes out to say that 13 of their 14 footballs are 2 PSIs under the minimum. So Brady's hearing that. He's got to say, what's going on here? And it was a complete lie, started by Kensel.
Right, and you have no standardization, no written protocol where all the footballs are charted and recorded for posterity, and now there will be.
But then another thing, remember about the text and all that, oh, we don't want your phone, we just want this and that.
Right.
Look what's coming out now.
His pool cover.
He didn't want this. He knocked on Manning. That came out. This other thing, he called someone a stooge. That came out. And they wonder why he didn't want them to have it.
His agent or somebody said, it's going to cost you $8,500 for a pool cover. And he said, what's wrong with the other pool cover? And the other guy gave some reason. He said, well, what color? I said, I want it in white. He said, you can't get it in white. He said, what kind of stupid thing is that? There's no white pool cover.
But that's what makes me laugh. They say, well, all we want to do is not going to come out, any of that other information. Look what's coming out now. Well, you don't think he's embarrassed about the Manning comment?
I'm sure he is.
But I mean, the whole thing is a joke, started by Mortensen with that article and not changing.
Well, today Antonio Cromartie of the Jets came out and said the whole thing was ridiculous. The maximum Brady should get is a $25,000 fine because that's what's written in the rules. And Cromartie's, there's nobody who's less of a Brady fan, maybe Terrell Suggs.
Ron, say this happened, right? Brady says, I don't care what you do, I want them at 12.5. And say they did take him in there and let some air out. Okay, we want him because these idiot referees aren't going to do it. They haven't been doing it. You know? And then people, you just, all you have to do is look at this. They say it helped them out. Second half of the Indianapolis game is the best he's ever thrown a football. They scored 28 points in the second half with the ball supposedly over 12.5. Against Seattle, the best defense in football over the last 5 years, he was, what was he, 37 for 50?
I think he might have been 38. But 30, anyway, he was phenomenal.
He threw the ball great with the balls over 12.5. So, I mean, to make a big deal out of this is a total disgrace. And I'll tell you, Brady is not going to accept any punishment. I'll tell you that.
Well, the Brady-Manning debate seems to be back on. I don't know why. Brady says he's going to play another 7 or 8 years, which he's not going to play another 7 or 8 years.
And Manning, too?
And Manning, right. Manning's going to play two. I don't know if Manning's going to play two, maybe one.
Yeah.
Certainly anybody who watched Manning last year saw he couldn't throw the ball downfield by the end of the year. Now, Manning...
He's still one of the smartest quarterbacks in football.
Manning's a technician. He's had a great arm. He can't say enough great things about Peyton Manning. He's a great pitch man. He's a great representative for the NFL.
He's great in commercials.
Right. But John Gruden said, if I have to pick one guy... He's there as a coach, it's about winning. And Brady's about winning. He's about winning championships. He's about winning football games.
You know what I love too, McGinnis, when I interviewed McGinnis the other day and he came out about all these people that are jealous of the Patriots. And he goes, all these former players that we played against and we won Super Bowls against, they're the ones that are complaining about this and that, about Spygate and that. And he goes, half the time they don't even know what they're talking about. Because they're saying, and they cheated all these other times. And McGinnis goes, when did we even ever cheat? Number one, he goes, we never use a Spygate, what they're talking about there. None of us ever heard about it. And he goes, other times, what are they talking about? Spying on teams working out? No one ever heard anything about that. He goes, but he goes, they're jealous. He goes, that's a problem the Patriots have right now. Everybody's jealous of their success.
Well,
I'd love to see him win the Super Bowl this year.
It'll be tough because you have to wonder about odd coincidences, you know, pass interference calls at the wrong time, holding calls at the wrong time.
These officials won't listen to, these officials, they're part-timers too, right?
They're
not going to listen to someone coming down from Goodell's office, and no one's going to go down until if that ever came out.
I don't know. I, you know, I, I just don't know.
They're going to have the best offense in football. They're going to be unstoppable. No one's going to stop that offense.
I think certainly the addition of Scott Chandler, assuming he can stay healthy.
That offensive line is going to be strong, too.
So if you have two massive tight ends, Gronkowski and Chandler, and people are saying Dobson looks better. Again, you know, how much credibility do you want to put for a few workouts?
But, Ron, another thing you have to look at, right now, Edelman for the Patriots is the best receiver in football. For the Patriots, I'd take him over any other receiver. All right? Amendola, after the way he played at the end of the year last year, and I love to see him be the third down back, coming out of the backfield, pass situations. Amendola, you got Gronk, and like you said, Chandler. That offensive line, I'm telling you, they're younger and they're tougher, led by Stork at center. That offensive line, as the season goes on, they're going to get better and better. They got that guard from Florida State they're really high about. And the guard from Wake Forest. And plus they have, you know, they have Vollmer and Sol, the two strong tackles. I mean, they're going to be.
Well, it's always about one thing.
Health.
You know, you get the wrong guy hurt or a couple
but
of guys hurt.
Aren't you excited about this team?
No, absolutely. You know, there's no reason to be negative. And the secondary is obviously a question. I think most people think Butler's going to be competent. They're not saying he's going to be a superstar. He's going to be a competent player.
Very good. Very good.
Terrell Brown, the guy they got from Oakland, he's 30 years old. He was hurt last year. He's been mostly a starter for the last four seasons for good team.
San Fran.
And he apparently has found new life with the Patriots. They have more. Well, obviously they have Mayo back, who's steady.
They'll have the best linebacking core in football.
They have Sheard, who's a good pass rusher and apparently feels very comfortable with what the Patriots having him do. They have their number one draft choice, Malcolm Brown, and hopefully easily will be back. You know, they said he has shown some explosiveness when he's been out there. Now, again, it's early. We'll know more once the games get going.
And they're good at safety, too. Kid they picked, the kid from Stanford, they said he's looking real good.
Right. They, you know, again.
And Harmon, they got there at safety, too, and Chung.
Right.
And then you have McCourty. And you got, like you said, Butler's good, Ron. He's not just going to be adequate.
Right. So there's reasons not to be negative. Now, the running back situation.
Well, they got two good runners in Gray and Blount.
Right. If you know.
And then Bolden will be their third.
Right. Blount misses the first game.
With the first game.
And Le'Veon Bell misses for the Steelers, and you know, so he's their primary weapon. They have Antonio Brown at wide receiver, obviously, who's really good too.
But Ron, you look at that team. They're strong all over the field, but at one cornerback spot. I mean, if people are saying that one, if Brown comes true,
yeah,
what's his name from Rutgers?
Logan Ryan.
Ryan, I think he's going to be better because I think he learned last year. When you get burnt a couple of times in the Super Bowl, you know, that time he played off the receiver one time, I mean, you work on those things and you become better. He has talent. But just look at the team. Look at every position of the team. The one area is the right cornerback side. If they can get half-decent play at the right cornerback side, they're better than most teams at every other position.
Well, and the guards. They're going to be inexperienced at guard, probably.
Well, they still have Wendell.
Right. But, this, again, everything's about health.
I'm excited.
Well, no.
I think they're going to win it again. I really do, if they stay healthy, like you said.
Well, again, I'm worried about karma smacking them down, especially for you, the officials.
Hey, how's the volleyball team going to look this year?
Well, Melrose had four players, Kat Torpy, Victoria Crovo, who else? Caitlin McGinnis and Marissa Cataldo play in the Bay State games. The team did not, I think it's the Northeast. They did not finish among the top three, but they were competitive in most of the matches. They split 1-1. I don't know exactly how they format that, whether it's time because the scores are different, but so they were competitive. Last year, I think the team was something like 21-3. They didn't get to the D2 North finals.
They lost to Weston, was it?
Right, they lost to Weston, who will bring back a strong team still.
That's that coach, the coach that was in here.
Coach Fabe. So they're probably the team to beat.
Are his two daughters back?
Two of the daughters. Well, I think one graduated and he has two back, including their star player. And they, I don't think they're playing Bishop Fenwick again this year because of scheduling conflicts, but they have a really terrific home schedule, including Notre Dame of Hingham.
Oh, wow. They were number one in the state, weren't they?
Right, I think so, for much of the season. So they're going to be a great take at the middle school. And you have a lot of younger players developed. I've heard great things about Kat Torpy's hitting. I haven't seen it, so I can't comment. But I'm expecting that they're going to be, you know, very competitive as they are every year.
Yeah, I talked to her at one of her sister's basketball games, and she said she's really been working on that, attacking. So hopefully that's an addition. You know, the rest of the front line is going to be solid. I forget, is it Mo Kay? What's that girl? Is she back? The outside hitter? Is it
Hannah Mulcahy.
Mulcahy.
Right. I think she'll be a senior this year.
And Victoria should have a great year.
Right. So I know
it's going to be another real good team.
Victoria's been working hard on volleyball.
And little Caitlin in the back row, she's got another year under her belt.
There's always some younger players coming along to fill in and take over. You know, I would expect football will be, a perennially competitive team.
I'll tell you, Morris, I have to say, you know, after doing the games for how many years we've done them, his teams are unbelievably prepared. You know, they come back. I mean, every year they come back. I mean, this last class was great.
The last class had stars in multiple sports, hockey, football, a split along lacrosse and baseball.
So they're going to be hurting losing those players. I mean, that was a heck of a class. The class before it, too, with Eric Mercer, that class there was a great class. This last class was very strong. But every year it seems like, the one thing that impresses me about the football team is I know that Morris coaches one of the lines too, the head coach, and Kent coaches the other line. Every year the lines get better and better as the year goes on. So the coaching there is unbelievable. And, you know, they'll be strong again, you know. And they have a lot of talent coming back. Is it Padini? What's his name?
Padini.
Padini.
Mike Padini.
He may be one of the top five players the program has ever had. You know, I put him right up there.
Is he going to be quarterback this year?
I don't know if they're going to put him at back, running back, or quarterback, but I put him up there with Pizzotti and those kids. I mean, he's just a super player. They lost the Super Bowl because he got hurt. He got a concussion at halftime. I think it was a concussion. They would have won the Super Bowl. They lost by a touchdown. You know, and if he didn't get hurt, they definitely would have won it because Hickey was getting tired. They were running him, you know, all the time instead of putting Zach.
Well, it's tough for high school kids to go through a long season with as many games as they have.
But that was a great class.
And staying healthy. No, absolutely.
And great team. Great football team.
Well, and they're all, highly regarded kids. And kids who, I think Brian McLaughlin, last I had heard, he was going to Annapolis. So those are the kind of kids that you have to be able to root for because they're going to represent your community well and represent your country.
Yeah, and Zach's going to be playing with his brother, I think, at St. Anselm's. I think that's where they go.
Oh, exactly.
So he'll be playing football. I'm glad for them. Hopefully that he got a scholarship, too, because he's talented. Outside linebacker, he's a tremendous outside linebacker. He could definitely play,
No question. The sports that produce quality teams with a lot of successful kids year after year, there's a reason for it. And unfortunately, sometimes it's not going to happen for every sport. It can't happen. But you want it to happen for as many sports as you can to see those kids enjoy the success that they all deserve for the work they put in.
Yeah, and the kid like Hickey, the running back and safety, he's going to,
Amherst,
a Little Ivy school, Amherst.
Right.
And he'll be playing there, so.
Or is it Williams?
One of those teams. Ivy team.
Could be Williams. I can't remember which one. I've enjoyed being with you. I'm Ron Sen.
And I'm Ralph LaBella, and thank you for watching Let's Talk Sports.